So let me now tell you about position-aware graph neural networks that are going to solve part of the problem. So imagine there are two types of tasks on the graphs, right? There is what we are going to call structure-aware tasks, and there is position-aware tasks. And again, this is just to illustrate this concept about how graph structure may affect the underlying labels. And in reality, in the real world, you know, every task is a bit of a structure-aware and a bit of a position-aware. But some tasks will be more position-aware, some will be more structure-aware, and we'd like to have models that can operate in both regimes, right? In structure-aware tasks, for example, labeling of the nodes for this simple graph with two connected triangles, if nodes are labeled according to these labels A and B here, then this is one way, because the structure of the node and the neighborhood basically defines its label. A different type of a task is what we call position-aware task, where, for example, if you think about community detection is a position-aware task, right? Here, you know, nodes on one side have one label and nodes on the other side have the other label, even though their local structures are comparable or isomorphic, right? Like node 1 and node 2, they basically have the same neighborhood structures around them. So in structure-aware tasks, they should be labeled with the same label. In position-aware, they might be labeled with different labels because they are in different parts of the network. And the point is that the GNNs, the graph neural networks, the GCN, graph sage, graph attention network, they work well for structure-aware tasks. Right here, basically, we can differentiate V1 and V2 because they will have different computational graphs, as illustrated here. Right, V1 has the following computation graph. V2 has a different computation graph, just because V2 has three neighbors and V1 has two neighbors even at the first hop. So we are able to distinguish them, and meaning we are able to assign them different labels because they'll have different embeddings, because they have different computation graphs. How about position-aware task, where now we change the labeling of the nodes, you know, let's say according to the communities? In this case, a plain GNN is going to fail because nodes V1 and V2, this labeled here in the graph, have the same computation graphs because they're kind of symmetric with each other, right? So the point is that now, because they have the same computation graphs, and again, because we are assuming there is no discriminative node feature information given to us, the two nodes have the same local neighborhood structure, they have the same computation graph, which means they will have the same embedding, which means the classifier will have to assign them the same label. And in this case, we want them to label them differently. So the question is, how can we extend graph neural networks, deep learning methods, that would be able to solve or work well in this, you know, toy example that kind of tries to illustrate this notion of position-aware prediction tasks. And the key idea for this part is the notion of an anchor, because the way you know your location is to know what is your position or against some reference point, right? And we are going to call these anchors to be reference points. And if I know how far away from reference points I am, and you know kind of how far away you are from different reference points, then we can distinguish our locations. It's almost like you want to triangulate the position of the node inside the graph by characterizing some kind of a distance to the anchor node. So that's the idea. The idea is we want to have a reference point and to quantify the location. So we are going to use this notion of anchor nodes to give us these locations, right? So we are going to basically pick these anchors at random, and we are going to say, let's pick node, let's say S1 in this case, and let's call it an anchor node. And then we are going to represent the position of V1 and V2 by their relative distance to the anchor node. And because the distance of V1 and V2 in this case to the anchor node S1 will be different, this basically means that this will allow us to differentiate or distinguish V1 from V2, right? So intuitively, the anchor node serves almost like as a reference point, as a coordinate axis that tells us how far away from different nodes are. And this basically allows us to kind of triangulate or locate the position of the node in the graph. Of course, we are not only going to use one anchor node. We are actually going to use multiple anchor nodes, because if we use multiple anchor nodes, we can better characterize the position of a node in different regions of the graph. So kind of, if we have multiple anchor nodes, we are able to better distinguish or set our position. Of course, we don't want to have too many because then it becomes computationally hard. But, you know, having some number of them, and there's actually a theory how many we want to have, we can characterize node's position in the network quite well. Here in this case, S1 and S2 are anchor nodes. V1 and V2 are nodes of interest. And I'm simply saying, you know, V1 is one hop away from S1 and two hops away from S2, while V2 is two hops away from S1 and one hop away from S2. And now this kind of allows us to distinguish V1 from V2, because they are at different distances from these anchor nodes. There is another generalization that turns out to be important, is that we don't want to really only talk about anchor nodes, we want to talk about anchor sets, right? So we are going to generalize this notion of an anchor node from a single node to a set of nodes. And then we are going to define the distance between the node of interest and the anchor set as the minimum distance to any of the nodes in the anchor set, right? And the idea here is that this will allow us to even triangulate the position of the node at a much more fine-grained level, because anchor sets will allow us to provide more precise position information, right? And it will allow us to keep the total number of anchors to be still small. So what I mean by this is that, for example, I could say, let's have now anchor sets. I have anchor node S1, I have anchor node S2, but then also have an anchor set, I'll denote it as S3, that includes node V3 and S1. And now I'm going to characterize the distance of a given node against that anchor set. And in this case, for example, if I'm interested in position of V3, V3 will have a distance of 0 to the anchor set S3 because it is part of the anchor set. While V2 is going to have a distance of 1 because the closest node in the anchor set to V1 is one hop away. What does this mean? That, for example, if we would, as we had before, if I only use S1 and S2 as my anchor nodes or anchor sets, then V3 and V1 cannot be differentiated with each other. They have the same distances. But now if I use this anchor set of size 2, I can actually differentiate V1 and V3. And again, there is a nice theory that says that it is beneficial to use anchor sets of different sizes, because then the number of anchor sets, the number of coordinates, the number of reference points you need to locate a node in the graph is relatively small. It's smaller than if you would just use anchor nodes like S1 and S2 and add multiple anchor nodes. So what is the summary so far? We have just developed this positional encoding of a node in the graph, where we are going to represent node's position by its distance to a randomly selected anchor sets. And each dimension in this encoding will tell me the will be tied to a given anchor set and will be the minimum distance from a node of interest to any of the nodes in the anchor set. That is the idea of how we are going to create this positional encoding. Now, before I move on and use how this positional information is used, the way, of course, you can ask how many of these sets do you need and how big they need to be. And what we are going to do is we are going to do the following. We are going to have an anchor sets of exponentially increasing size, but we are going to use exponentially fewer of them. Right, so we will have a lot of anchor sets of size 1, we'll have half that number of anchor sets of size 2, we'll have, you know, half of that number of anchor sets of size 4, size 8, size 16, and so on. So this means we'll have, you know, some relatively small number of anchor sets where each next anchor set size is going to be doubled, but the number of them will be half of what we had before. And that's usually a good way how to generate these anchor sets. And the nodes that belong to anchor sets, we simply select them uniformly at random. And then, we characterize this positional encoding of a node by simply the minimum distance from the node to the any of the nodes in the given anchor set. So, now, how do we use this positional information? A simple way of using a positional information is to use it as an augmented node feature. And this works really well in practice. So basically, we just enrich the feature descriptor of a node with this positional information characterized by the shortest path distance to the anchor sets. The issue here is that since each dimension of position encoding is tied to a random anchor, dimensions of positional encoding can be randomly permuted, and the encoding could be basically is semantically the same, meaning without changing its meaning. So, and what this means, imagine you permute the input dimensions of a normal neural network, the output will change. So what is a more rigorous solution than just using these positional encodings as they are, is to design a special set of neural network operators that can maintain this permutational invariant property of positional encoding. So basically, that the position encoding is order invariant, which you can achieve through, let's say, some kind of sum aggregator or aggregators that are order invariant. Because permuting the input feature dimension will only result in the permutation of the output dimension, but the value of each dimension shouldn't change. And, you know, there is a paper that introduces position-aware graph neural networks to say how you can do this in a more rigorous way. But the key here is this notion of an anchor and the notion that you can quantify the position of a node in the graph by the distance to the anchor, and that allows us to now improve the expressiveness of graph neural networks, because nodes won't only know what is their local neighborhood structure around them, but they will also know what is their location or position in the neural network.